morning, everybody.
Morning.
Please sit down. And a very warm welcome. Well done for braving all the elements and getting here this morning. It's not very pleasant out there, is it? And welcome to everybody watching from home. Welcome if anybody's watching this at some future date. So welcome to our service of Holy Communion this morning. And we hope it will be an important step on your journey of faith, wherever you might be on that. And can I just add, thank you very much for all your wishes. While I have been indisposed, I am now fully recovered. Thank you very much indeed. Okay, so we've gone 21st century today, so just bear with me while it's closed itself down. This is not a good start, but it'll all be fine. Okay, so let's have a moment of quiet before we begin our worship this morning. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
So please stand if you're able, and we'll sing our first hymn, Praise to the Lord the Almighty. And it's Mission Praise 56, if you'd like to read it. Are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry, and repent of all our sins, for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, Forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen.
May Almighty God have mercy on you, forgive you your sins, and bring you to everlasting life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen. Please stand if that's comfortable for you, and we'll say together the Gloria. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. And the collect, the special prayer for today. Almighty and everlasting God, you are always more ready to hear than we to pray, and to give more than either we desire or deserve. Pour down upon us the abundance of your mercy, forgiving us those things of which our conscience is afraid, and giving us those good things which we are not worthy to ask. But through the merits and mediation of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please sit down for our first reading.
First reading is taken from Exodus chapter 1, verse 8 to verse 10 of chapter 2. Then a new king to whom Joseph meant nothing came to power in Egypt. Look, he said to his people, the Israelites have become far too numerous for us. Come, we must deal shrewdly with them, or they will become even more numerous. And if war breaks out, we'll join our enemies, fight against us, and leave the country. So they put slave masters over them to oppress them with forced labour, and they built Pithom and Ramesses as store cities for Pharaoh. But the more they were oppressed, the more they multiplied and spread. So the Egyptians came to dread the Israelites and worked them ruthlessly. They made their lives bitter with harsh labour in brick and mortar and with all kinds of work in the fields. In all their harsh labour, the Egyptians worked them ruthlessly. The king of Egypt said to the Hebrew midwives, whose names were Shifra and Puah, when you are helping the Hebrew women during childbirth on the delivery stool, if you see that the baby is a boy, kill him, but if it is a girl, let her live. The midwives, however, feared God and did not do what the king of Egypt had told them to do. They let the boys live. Then the king of Egypt summoned the midwives and asked them, why have you done this? Why have you let the boys live? The midwives answered Pharaoh, Hebrew women are not like Egyptian women. They are vigorous and give birth before the midwives arrive. So God was kind to the midwives, and the people increased and became even more numerous. And because the midwives feared God, he gave them families of their own. Then Pharaoh gave this order to all his people. Every Hebrew boy that is born, you must throw into the Nile, but let every girl live. Now a man of the tribe of Levi married a Levite woman, and she became pregnant and gave birth to a son. When she saw that he was a fine child, she hid him for 3 months. But when she could hide him no longer, she got a papyrus basket for him and coated it with tar and pitch. Then she placed the child in it and put it among the reeds along the bank of the Nile. His sister stood at a distance to see what would happen to him. Then Pharaoh's daughter went down to the Nile to bathe, and her attendants were walking along the river bank. She saw the basket among the reeds and sent her female slave to get it. She opened it and saw the baby. He was crying, and she felt sorry for him. This is one of the Hebrew babies, she said. Then his sister asked Pharaoh's daughter, shall I go and get one of the Hebrew women to nurse the baby for you? Yes, go, she answered. So the girl went and got the baby's mother. Pharaoh's daughter said to her, take this baby and nurse him for me, and I will pay you. So the woman took the baby and nursed him. When the child grew older, she took him to Pharaoh's daughter, and he became her son. She named him Moses, saying, I drew him out of the water. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
This morning's second reading is taken from Romans chapter 12, verses 1 to 8. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in the view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. For by the grace given me, I say to every one of you, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment, in accordance with the faith of God, as tribute to each of you. For just as each of us has one body with many members, and these members do not all have the same function, so in Christ we, though many, form one body, and each member belonging to all the others, we have different gifts, according to the grace given to us, each of us. If your gift is prophesying, then prophesy in accordance with your faith. If it is serving, then serve. If it is teaching, then teach. If it is to encourage, then give encouragement. If it is given, then give generously. If it is to lead, do it diligently. If it is to show mercy, do cheerfully. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Well, please stand if it's comfortable for you as we sing our second hymn this morning, He is Lord.
Every tongue confess that He
Shall we, before we continue, shall we just have a little moment of quiet and each of us offer up a prayer for Lauren, which is obviously in great pain at the moment. So just have a moment of quiet. We pray for God's healing touch on her. The Gospel reading this morning, we're hearing the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew. Glory to you, O Lord. When Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say the Son of Man is?" They replied, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets." "But what about you?" he asked. "Who do you say I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." Jesus replied, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but by my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gate of Hades will not overcome it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." Then he ordered his disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah. This is the Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. May I speak in the name of the living God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Have you ever played the Who Am I game? Anybody played it? No? Where one person pretends to be somebody famous, they think of it in their head, and then people ask them questions. Are you a man? Are you alive? And all you can answer is yes or no. Okay, until you get to a point where you think you've got enough information, and then you go for it, and you make an educated guess as to who that person is. I did use it a lot in school when we were revising characters from history. It was a good fun way of revision. But can we ever really know another person? For instance, do you really know who I am? You might know that I was a teacher, that I'm a grandma, but do you really know me? And the truth is that no one ever knows anyone else completely. Getting to know somebody is a long, ongoing process. It takes years of interaction. And over time, your relationship changes as you get to know more and more about one another. And the same can be said about our relationship with God. In our gospel reading, Jesus is trying to find out what people are saying about who he is. He's already aware that some Jewish leaders are unhappy with his teachings, but now he's in an area north of Galilee, a predominantly Gentile region, and one in which people worship a wide variety of gods, including those associated with the Greek and Roman cultures, such as the Greek god Pan, a place where pagan temples and idols were abundant. How are his teachings being received by people in this area? Jesus must be aware that all sorts of theories will be going around about who he is. Some of these are close to the truth, others are way off the mark. So he asked his disciples, "Who do the people say the Son of Man is? What have you heard?" The disciples respond that they've heard people say that Jesus is one of the prophets. And to be fair, this is what their scriptures have led them to believe would happen. So they named John the Baptist, Elijah, and Jeremiah. Elijah and Jeremiah were monumental figures in the history of Judaism who did very special things during their ministry. And now here's this man, Jesus, who's also doing remarkable works. So it's a perfectly logical conclusion that one of these prophets may have returned. By getting his disciples to consider who other people think he is, Jesus is trying gently to move their understanding forward towards that eureka moment, that split second when everything will suddenly slot into place and they'll finally understand the truth. Surely they must be close by now. After all, they know him better than anyone else. They've been his constant companions for over 2 years. They've listened to him teaching. They've witnessed him healing people, walking on water, feeding huge crowds of people, not once but twice, casting out demons, even raising someone from the dead. So after hearing the conflicting and inaccurate views of other people, Jesus now turns to them and asks, "But what about you? Who do you say I am?" And like lightning, Simon Peter says, "You're the Messiah, the Son of the living God." And at this point, I have a mental image of the other 11 disciples looking around at one another, open-mouthed in shock. How did he know that? Simon Peter, the disciple who tends to speak first and think later, has come to the right conclusion. Well, yes, but not quite. Yes, Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of the living God, the Messiah who the Jews have been waiting for to deliver them from oppression. But, like their contemporaries, Simon Peter and the other disciples probably assume that if Jesus is the Messiah, he's been sent to lead an insurrection against their Roman oppressors. But Jesus' task is much greater than this. He has come to die on the cross to free us from sin so that all of us may gain eternal life. And because of this misunderstanding about the term Messiah, Jesus tells his disciples not to share this truth with anyone else for the time being. The world is not ready to hear this answer, and perhaps more importantly, the disciples are not yet able to explain it accurately. Nevertheless, Jesus seems happy to accept the partial truth that Simon Peter has spoken, probably thinking that as events in Jerusalem unfold, the whole truth will be revealed to all the disciples. But for now, this is a giant leap forward in the disciples' understanding. So Jesus blesses Simon Peter and declares that this shall be the place where he will build his church. This is the first time ever that the word church is mentioned in Scripture. But what sort of church is Jesus referring to? When we hear the word church, we tend to picture a building similar to the one that we're in now this morning. But when Jesus talks about building a church, he is talking about building up a group of people bound together by their faith with the common purpose of spreading the good news about Jesus the Messiah. A church built on the foundations of the apostles and prophets, which has Jesus as its cornerstone. And in the excerpt we heard from Paul's letter to the Romans that Pam read for us, Paul also talks about the church as being comprised of members. He describes how we, as members of this church, are crucial working parts of a living, working body. We're all interdependent and mutually supporting, all doing different tasks according to our individual skills. But without any single one of us, this living organism, this church, would be less effective in its mission. Understanding just who we believe Jesus to be helps us to discern exactly what he's calling us to do to help his kingdom grow. Every one of us has a unique relationship with God, a relationship that is ever changing according to our own life experiences and current circumstances. And it's not a linear path either. It goes backwards as well as forwards, as Simon Peter would clearly demonstrate when he denies knowing Jesus not once but three times, just a short while after proclaiming him to be the Messiah. Here at St. John's and St. Thomas's, we're standing on the brink of a great opportunity. Not only do we have Simon's commitment to be our priest in charge for the next 2 years, we also have the Macri team who are working to ensure that all 9 Anglican churches in Macclesfield can remain open, that they can continue to provide focal points for worship for their existing congregations, but also they can reach out and spread God's word further afield. So let's make the most of this unique situation and pray that God will reveal to us new and original ways in which we can work together as a church that transcends the boundaries of our individual parishes, so that we can make the most of the limited resources that we have and so be able to share our faith with others. As Simon's licensing and installation service draws ever closer, now seems like a good time for us to focus on our own relationship with Jesus, to think and pray about it. How might each one of us respond to Jesus's question, "But what about you? Who do you say I am. Amen.
So who do you say Jesus is? It's your chance to respond to that in the words of the Creed. Please stand if you are able. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things are made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven, was incarnate
from the Holy Spirit,
and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he suffered.
Crucified and the Pontius Pilate.
He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please be seated for our intercessions.
The response to our prayers this morning, at the end of each prayer I'm going to say, Christ, Son of the living God, please can you respond, hear us and help us. Christ, Son of the living God,
hear us and help us.
Gathered as the Church of God, members of the body of Christ, let us pray together. Lord, transform us by your love, that we may know and do your will, that we may live and work to your praise and glory, through Christ, the King of glory, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, word world without end. Christ, Son of the living God,
hear us
and help us. Lord, we present ourselves, our souls and bodies to you. You give us life, you give us love, you give us yourself. May we give our lives, our love, ourselves to you. We pray for the unity of your church, that we may work together for the good of all. We pray especially for Simon as he prepares for his licensing service next Monday. And we pray for all those involved with Macri as they plan for the future growth of your church in this town. We give thanks for the gifts you have given us. Let us use them to your glory. Christ, Son of the living God,
hear us and help us.
Fill your world, O Lord, with wonder at creation and recognition of our mutual human responsibility as stewards of this beautiful planet. Help us to reform what is at fault and hope in the possibilities of living in peace with God and with one another. Christ, Son of the living God,
hear us and help us.
We pray for all people, that their talents and abilities may be used. Bless each in their vocation and work. We remember those who are unemployed and all those who found their work dull and repetitive. We remember all those whose talents are wasted and thwarted. Christ, Son of the living God,
hear us and help us.
Bless our homes with holiness and hospitality, with cheerfulness and kindliness, with generosity and goodness. We pray for our loved ones, our neighbours, our friends, and the communities to which we belong, and the places where we work. Christ, Son of the living God, hear us and help us. We pray for all those who suffer through the cruelty of others, for all who have no confidence in themselves or in the world. Remember those who feel lonely and isolated, and those who feel rejected or betrayed. We pray for all those who are in trouble, need, or sickness. We pray for the work of all those who heal and comfort, all who visit the sick and counsel the distressed. And from our own community, we pray especially for Lauren. We also pray for David Harrison, who has had a fall this week and is currently in hospital. And for Sylvia's daughter, Linda, who's also back in hospital for further treatment, and for Sylvia herself, and also for Michael Luca. Christ, Son of the living God, hear us and help us. We give thanks for all who have been strengthened by their faith, for all who have died in faith, and for all who mourn them. And we pray especially for Michael Kurek and his family, and for Stuart Crabtree, whose funeral will take place at Henbury on Tuesday. I think a few people here will know Stuart. We pray for all those who are mourning, and we pray for your comfort on their families and friends. Christ, Son of the living God, hear us and help us. Fill our hearts, O Lord, with thankfulness and praise as we recall your faithfulness and live in love. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
If you are able, would you please stand? Christ is our peace. He has reconciled us to God in one body by the cross. We meet in his name and share his peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let's share the peace with each other and with those who are also at home watching now. I thought you were going to do a Spanish football game. Come now to our next hymn, that's number 27. I will offer up my life. Thank you. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this bread to set before you, which earth has given and human hands have made. It will become for us the bread of life.
Blessed be God forever.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this wine to set before you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become for us the cup of salvation.
Blessed be God forever.
The Lord is here.
His Spirit is with us.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is indeed right. It is our duty and our joy at all times and in all places to give you thanks and praise. Holy Father, Heavenly King, Almighty and Eternal God, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. For he is your living word. You, through him you have created us from the beginning and formed us in your own image. Through him you have freed us from the slavery of sin, giving him to be born of a woman and to die upon the cross. You raised him from the dead and exalted him to your right hand on high. Through him you have sent upon us your holy and life-giving Spirit and made us a people for your own possession. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your glory, your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying,
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Accept our praises, Heavenly Father, through your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. And as we follow his example and obey his command, grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us his body and his blood. Who, in the same hour that he was betrayed, took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. Therefore, Heavenly Father, we remember his offering of himself made once for all upon the cross. We proclaim his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension. We look for the coming of your kingdom, and with this bread and this cup we make the memorial of Christ, your Son, our Lord. Great is the mystery of faith.
Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again.
Accept through him, our great High Priest, this our sacrifice of thanks and praise. And as we eat and drink these holy gifts, in the presence of your divine majesty, renew us by your Spirit, inspire us with your love, and unite us in the body of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Through him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, with all who stand before you with earth and heaven, we worship you, Father Almighty, in songs of everlasting praise. Blessing and honour and glory and power be yours forever and ever. Amen. We sit or kneel for the Lord's Prayer. As our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us.
Lead us not into temptation,
but deliver us from evil. The kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Amen.
Be present, Lord Jesus Christ, our risen High Priest, and make yourself known in the breaking of the bread. Amen. Draw near with faith, receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood, which he shed for you. Drink, eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Thank you.
God of all mercy, in this Eucharist you have set aside our sins and given us your healing. Grant that we who are made whole in Christ may bring that healing to this broken world. In the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Father of all, we give you thanks and praise that when we were still far off, you met us in your Son and brought us home. Dying and living, he declared your love, gave us grace, and opened the gates of glory. May we who share Christ's body live his risen life. We who drink his cup bring life to others. We whom the Spirit lights give light to the world. Keep us firm in the hope you have set before us, so we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Now we turn to a church warden for notices, please.
First of all, thank you to everybody who worked on clearing up the garden and the car park. Particularly the car park corner, thank you very much. We've only got three or four people going to be here for breakfast next Saturday. So you don't feel you've got to, you know, if something happens and you've signed, then don't worry about it. But we could do with a few more people coming and already some idea if a few more people are going to turn up than the four of us.
Is there breakfast provided?
Oh, breakfast will be
definitely
provided.
Will there be cake
for us? There's cake now. Lauren's very kindly brought us a cake.
No cake for the breakfast, but we can overlook that. There will be breakfast.
Well, we sometimes we have croissant, and sometimes we have bacon. So we have in the past occasionally had bacon sandwiches, but so only for his birthday. Yes, it's the birthday breakfast if we have bacon. There are knitting patterns outside. Karen's brought lots of old magazines. If anybody would like to help yourselves, I'll get some ideas. There are flyers for the Hope concert on the 29th of September at URC. Also that Hope are looking for an ambassador to spread the word of Hope. Carol will tell us all about it if we need to ask any questions. I think that's about it. Thank you. Oh, it's Cameo on Friday. Is that here? Right, Cameo on Friday here. 2 o'clock? 2 o'clock. And no craft club tomorrow because it's bank holiday.
Institution
on Monday of next week. not bank holiday Monday. And there will be cake there, yes.
And you are all invited. It'd be great to see as many as you who can come to go up to St. Thomas's. And we're going to have we'll celebrate. And this will be a great chance. It'll be a very simple service, actually, but just a chance to get together. Bishop Sam will be there, and he'll be great as well. So the more of you can come along. This isn't so much about me. It's that the church is together, looking forward. That's the primary thing we're going to be working towards, so that's wonderful. So we're going to stand and sing now, 109, Creation Sings the Father's Song.
Thank you.
God of hope, fill you with all joy and peace in believing. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always. Amen.
Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ. Amen.